Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Today kicks off the new podcast series here at BusyWorksBeats.com. We are now available on iTunes. So if you're listening on iTunes, be sure to go to BusyWorksBeats.com/podcast if you want the visual aspect of the podcast. Today we're going to go over how to get traffic to your website. How do you get views? How do you get people to come to your website? You know, I get this question a lot. And what I think people are doing is analyzing what I'm doing now, okay? And what you need to realize is that I wasn't where I'm at now all the time. I started in a completely different place, and I worked to where I am now. And you have to understand that the actions I take now were built off the actions I took before. So we need to travel back in time to see good ways of achieving traffic the ways I did in the beginning, okay? So the first place we're going to come to is alexa.com/top sites. Here lists the top 500 sites on the web. This is where people go on the web. You know, there are very few websites that people go to. You know, if you think about it, you log in on the website, you might go to Facebook, you might log into your Twitter, or you may just have the apps on your phone, so you're not even really logging into the website. So you have Facebook, Twitter, okay? You might go to YouTube, check out some videos. You might go to your favorite video website, whether that's World Star Hip Hop or some other kind of popular site, and you may go to some other, you know, hobby site. That's about it. You know, there's really no other sites you go to on the internet. Now the rest of the sites that you go to were probably advertised or broadcasted onto the main websites, so you were probably led to some different website from a main website that you visit all the time. And if it wasn't from that main website, it was from the Google search. And as you look here at the top 500 sites on the web, Google is number one, okay? So let's analyze what you need to do with Google.com to even be found on the website. If somebody types in Google Beats or Hardcore Hip Hop Beats and you don't pop up, the chances of them knowing about you are zero, okay? Even if you're on the second page, you know, the percentage of people that are actually going to click on that second page are very low. So you need to be on the front page of Google. You need to be near the top. So to do that, you know, it deals with a lot of SEO, search engine optimization. But before you get into search engine optimization, you need to understand what even, you know, the search engines are looking for. They're looking for content. They're looking for things which increase the value of somebody else over time. So the way they judge if you're bringing value to the market are the parameters of SEO. You know, how many visits are you getting? How many backlinks do you have? You know, how many, keywords do you have that actually provide value for people searching that keyword? So they're called LSI keywords. I think that's the term for them. You want to look at LSI keywords. Look at backlinks, increasing your backlinks. How many other websites actually see value in your company and will actually have the guts to post your link on their website? Okay, think of it that way. Who would believe in your brand so much that they'll post a link to your website on their website? So they're putting their reputation at risk just so they can lead other people to your website. That's how strong your value creation has to be, to where even if another person were to put their reputation at risk, it would just increase because you are providing value. So that's the first step. You need to decide, what is your content? What is the value that you're bringing to the actual market? You might say your song. Okay, well, your song is one thing, and Google can't read songs. Okay, so you need to figure out a way to put some kind of text or some kind of thing where people respond in text on your website so that Google can see, okay, people are receiving value. This must be a good link. Let's put it towards the top. Now, there are tons of different things about SEO. Now, the best thing you need to start out with is understanding the difference between having a free website and a website of your own. If you have your own website, you can do a lot more with SEO, a lot more with managing your Google rankings. You can do a lot more, okay? If you have a blogger website, for example, it's already set up for you, so you really can't do much with the blogger website. You can't really optimize it. It's already set. It already has a certain structure to it. It already has certain things about it which are kind of locked in stone and you can't change them, okay? So if they're not performing well, you can't even change it anyway to perform better. So the first step, when you can, is to get your own website. Now, I go over and how to sell beats online, of course, at busyworksbeats.com, the whole process of how to start from scratch, how to start with $0, and how to make income. We go over that whole system. It's a system. I show you how to utilize free tools, how to monetize your content as you're getting sales at the same time. So you're building multiple streams of income, okay? These are all technologies, skills, strategies you can use to go from $0 to then gaining income for yourself so you can go pay for that website. You know, you don't do everything at once. You invest in your business over time. It's a sequence. It's a process. You don't just start with your own website putting in thousands of dollars into your website right away. It's just not how it works unless you want to waste money. Okay? So you need to understand the importance of Google searches and people typing in keywords. You know, does your website come up? What keyword are you even trying to rank for? Okay? What word do you want people to find you with if they type it into Google? Which keyword would that be? Okay, is it beats? Okay, if it's beats, you need to look at all the competition. It's going to be tons of competition. Not only do you have the new Beats 1 from Apple, you have everybody with their own Beats websites, okay? So Beats is probably not a good keyword. You need to think of something more precise that people might be typing into Google to then get to your website. Now, there are tools to help you figure out keywords you can focus on, but what you need to do is focus on content creation first. You need to focus on who are you even serving with your content? Who are you even trying to increase the value? Whose life are you trying to increase the value in? You really have to ask that question. Who are you even making products for? You know, I see it too many times. Producers just make beats just to make beats, and they just throw them out on the internet and just hope somebody stumbles across it. You know, you have to ask the question, who are you even trying to serve? Because if your beats are just for you and you're just putting up your own style because it's your own style, you can't expect it to sell because it's not serving any purpose. It's not serving anybody else other than yourself. And that's the problem the majority of the time, is that people are just serving themselves, thinking that they're going to go in business. But business is about servitude. So those are the things you need to take care of before you even get your own website. If it's free or not, you need to figure out who are you serving. Okay, and there are many mechanisms to go find out who you're serving. Again, we go over those in How to Sell Beats Online at busyworksbeats.com. So once you're, you know, once you're at the Google step, then you start building your own website, and then you start getting organic, it's called organic traffic, or traffic that you don't have to pay for. So now Google is sending you people daily to come to your website, and now it's up to you and your website to then figure out a way to do business with people coming to your website. So if you're not on Google, if you're not thinking even about people searching in Google and finding you, you really need to cut out a keyword, if it's not just your company name, something else that people are searching to find you in Google. And you need to be highly ranked for that thing. Now, there are strategies for that. Again, I'm not going to go in depth about that. Let's go to the next site here, the top 500 sites at alexa.com/top sites. The next site is facebook.com. If you're not on Facebook, you don't exist. Okay, it's a joke that goes around, but it's true. You know, if you're not on Facebook, people just assume you don't exist in reality. It's one of those phenomenon where everybody shifted over into a new realm or new paradigm all at once. You know, it's, we kind of stepped into the digital quickly with Facebook. You know, we went from everybody being outside in the 90s to now everybody disappearing and not being outside. And even if they are outside, they're on Facebook. So they transferred their personality and their presence all over to Facebook. So that's where all the attention is right now, Facebook. Second in the top sites here. So these top sites are based on traffic and how many people are constantly on the website. So if people are, put it this way, if you're trying to sell beats near the ocean and there's only two surfers out in the ocean, whereas there are millions of people in the city right next to the ocean, would you sit there on the ocean and try to sell your beats to two people, or would you go into the city and try to sell your beats to millions of people? It's simple. You would go to the city where it has millions of people. You need to go places where you can exchange. Business is about exchange. If there is no other person, you're not going to be exchanging with anybody. And exchange is about yes and no. Not everybody's going to want your beat. Okay, so you need to get over the self-confidence thing about receiving no's and rejection. Take that no, here's a better way to look at no's. If somebody says no, fine, move on. Okay, move on quickly. You need to get more no's so that you can get to your yes faster. You need to get tons of no's so that you get to your yes. And for every no, think of it this way. You know, the systems we show you at BusyWorksBeats.com and the How to Sell Beats online course, we show you how to build what's called a mailing list. And that mailing list costs money to maintain. It's not free. Well, it is free in the beginning, but it's not free over time. It's not free. So you don't want people on your mailing list who aren't going to respond to your messages, okay? The people who are essentially saying no. You don't want them to waste space where you can be serving somebody else. So that costs you. Somebody being on your list, it costs you money every month for them just sitting on that list being stagnant. And so you need to consider every no as a money-saving event. Okay, now, good, he said no. That saves me money every month, okay, that I don't need to spend on somebody who's not going to even be interested in what I have to offer. So you're saving your money for every no. That's a better way to look at it. Now, you won't understand that perspective until you start building your list and until that list starts costing you some money every month, okay? Now, getting back to Facebook.com, you know, you have to be in front of people. Build a profile. Now, here's the biggest thing I see with social media is people have pictures of cats, pictures of somebody else, pictures of another rapper, pictures of some brand that they don't even, if it's not your company, don't put it as your cover picture. Don't put it as your profile picture. For your profile picture, you need to put a picture of yourself and your profile, your head to your about your shoulder length is your profile or your chest, so that people can know your face and get to know it, because that's the only you that separates you from everybody else, your face, okay? Unless you have a twin, people are going to recognize you by your face. Even if everything else was the same, people are going to recognize you by your face, okay? So you need to put a picture of your face in your profile picture and put that profile picture across all of your social media platforms, all of them, so that you have what's called a uniform appearance in the web space. The biggest thing I see all the time, okay, I go to your SoundCloud, you have a picture of a cat. I go to your Facebook, you have a picture of you. I go to Twitter, you have a picture of some other brand that isn't even your company. It's no uniform, constant thing I see all the time, okay? So it's a big mistake we make as producers. So you need to change your profile, set it as one picture, and change every social media platform picture to that one picture of you and your face, so that people know they're dealing with a person, not a robot. Your cover picture should have something to do with your brand on Facebook. It should have something to do with you or your brand. It shouldn't be some random brand that you have nothing to do with, okay? So you stop promoting these other companies because they're not paying you anyway. So why are you promoting some other company? Now, again, let me try to think more things about Facebook. People are asking me about Facebook ads. You know, if you're thinking about ad money, spending money on ads before you even make money or before you even have a system that brings in money, you need to build the system first. Ad money is for multiplying your energy to where you are exchanging money for time because you don't have enough time to constantly do something. That's when you exchange money for time for ads. So if you're spending money on ads early in the game, early in your development, that's when you know, you know, the company's probably not going to do so well because you're getting relaxed early. You know, ad money is for when you can't extend yourself past a certain point. That's when ad money comes in because you can only do so much per day, you know. And, you know, I see it all the time. People just assume ads are going to automatically just get money. You know, for the $60 they may spend on a Facebook ad, they think they're going to get $70 back right away. It's just not how it works unless you have some kind of, it's called direct response system, okay? But even if you have a direct response system, it's not about that immediate $70. It's about helping a client over time. You want to give them as much value as you possibly can. And to do that, you have to be in communication with them. And we go over all those systems, again, in the How to Sell Beats online course at BusyWorksBeats.com. So that's Facebook in a nutshell. Now, YouTube, okay? Here's a stream of revenue a lot of people are skipping. Professional mixing secrets finally revealed. Get 3 free videos straight from the new Mixing Academy complete course package at busyworksbeats.com/mac. So YouTube, another missed opportunity. A lot of people are just throwing things on YouTube, you know, haphazardly. Think of YouTube as an extra stream of income. You know, it's a stream. It's just like putting your music on Spotify, putting it on, I'm trying to think of the paid platforms here, Pandora, and putting it on other sites. It's a streaming website, basically, where you get paid for the amount of streams. That's pretty much the same kind of setup. And you have to be thankful that they're even letting you in on receiving those ad revenues, because YouTube could just simply take ad money and not pay you at all. They don't have to pay you. Okay, so it's great that they even have partnership programs. And we even have a partnership offer. Let me go to my Facebook real quick because I don't know the link off the top of my head. And for those, just a quick note, for those who are trying to message me on Facebook, please go to busyworksbeats.com/support because I don't answer messages on Facebook. Okay, so let me find the link here. Where is it at? So if you view this link, you can add me on Facebook. My account's Caesar Game King King. You could type that in. Or I think my link is facebook.com/GameKingBWB. Okay. You can add me on Facebook. And here we have a post about, I said I work with one of the top YouTube partnership companies, Broadband TV, which I do. Click here to join, and you can click there and get a YouTube partnership. Now, with that YouTube partnership, you can now monetize your YouTube. So when people click on your video, you get paid for every ad that they watch. If they watch, I think they have to watch like 30 seconds of an ad. I don't know the rules, but just know that YouTube is an extra source of income. Now you may ask, okay, how do I make videos? Now there's a free website. I think it's called tunes2tube.com or tunes to tube, something like that, where you can just upload an image and upload your music. And then you have a video on YouTube. So there's no excuse to not have a video on YouTube nowadays. Now the point of putting your music on YouTube is not only to just let more people hear it, which is one of the benefits, is because remember, YouTube is the number three site people go to. So you need to put your stuff where people are so they can see it and gain interest. So not only are you posting to YouTube, you're also getting paid as an income stream from YouTube if you have a partnership. Now, there are some rules to partnerships. There are some requirements. You can't just get a partnership willy-nilly. You have to be accepted to the partnerships. But I could tell you Broadband TV is a great choice, because we have back-end stuff that helps us, you know, deal with YouTube a lot better, like our collaboration tools and different things, keyword things and et cetera, thumbnail help, a lot of tools on the back end, okay, and reporting and different things. So, you know, you can choose your YouTube partnership company. What I would do, though, is try to apply to one instead of being chosen by them, because if they're actively choosing people, that means they're probably not doing too well. You know, so you got to be careful with people just sending you random offers like that. So anyway, let's get back to the Alexa top 100 sites, top 500 sites here. So you need to be on YouTube. Simple as that. You need to be where people are. There's no excuse for not being in these places. There really is no excuse. Okay. Now the next site is Baidu.com. It's a Chinese language search engine. So in that case, that's different because it's a different language and most people watching this don't speak Chinese. Now, the fifth most visited website is Amazon.com. So are you on Amazon.com? How do you get on Amazon.com? You need to go through their policies. They change all the time. So even if I gave you a quick template of how to get on there, it would change by tomorrow because they change the restrictions a lot in their policies. So go to Amazon.com, and I'm assuming they have a support area where you can figure out how to get on to Amazon.com. Now, the question is, what do you sell on Amazon.com? You don't sell one instrumental on Amazon.com. What you want to sell is some collection of instrumentals. And we go over this in How to Sell Beats Online, how to actually create products, because producers don't realize that their main job is to create a product. That's why you're called a producer. A producer produces product. And we're not treating instrumentals like products. We're treating them just like something you throw away, you know, and you have to treat it like a real product. So we go over those principles again in that course. Now, when you get on Amazon, again, you want to be selling a package, some kind of product package, a collection of instrumentals for the most part. And there are other steps you need to get involved with. Now, if you can't get on Amazon, at least consider having an Amazon payment tool on your website. Now, Yahoo.com, I'm not going to go through all 500 websites. I'm just kind of brushing over this. to show you how to get traffic. It's all just based on where do people go. Okay. Now you need to get on those websites and figure out ways to where you can capture that traffic. Okay. So on yahoo.com, are you on the Yahoo searches, search engines? You need to go search your name and search what keywords you're trying to rank for on Yahoo and figure out, are you even listed on Yahoo? Wikipedia, again, one of those hard platforms to get onto without a lot of authority and social proof. QQ.com, never used it. It's a Chinese website. Twitter.com, almost everybody knows about Twitter. Get on Twitter. Again, make your profile picture the same as Facebook, the same as Google Plus, the same as YouTube. Make your cover art the same as Twitter, the same as Facebook. Now, you can have different cover arts, but as long as they relate to your brand or relate to your company. Now, I hear a lot of, since I said brand by accident, a lot of producers and business people think branding is the same as marketing. Branding is for Coca-Cola. They need to brand so that their name becomes a mental thing that everybody knows. So it's different. Branding is different than marketing. Branding is something that, you know, lasts for 500 years, whereas marketing is something you do now. You don't think about 500 years from now, you know. So branding is a huge, huge thing, and it deals with spending tons and tons of money. So get the word branding out of your vocabulary. It's not the right term you want to be focused on right now. And branding also doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get money right away. You know, for example, the Goodyear blimp flies over a stadium at a football game doesn't mean people are going to go out and buy tires at the football game. Okay, so you never know your return on investment when you're branding. Marketing, however, you can measure different parameters and things. So those are the main websites you need to focus on. If you're not on any of those websites that we mentioned, Google, Facebook, YouTube. Now, let me clarify. You need to have a keyword on Google. So not just when you type in your name, you pop up. Of course you're going to pop up. You're the only you, hopefully. You need to have a keyword. You need to have LSI keywords on your website to help you rank in Google. So you need to find at least three keywords for your website. Facebook.com, you need to make your profiles uniform. You need to create a business page on Facebook. You need to start gathering likes on Facebook. As social proof, this proves that your brand or your company, I should say, let me remove the word brand. Your company is someone to work with. Okay, that's what the Facebook likes are for. It doesn't mean anything else except your company has some type of authority in the market. That's all it means. YouTube.com. You need to have a page. You need to monetize. You need to get a YouTube partnership. Okay, so click that link if you add me on Facebook, or go to this link here in the video. It's a shortened link, so it's a little bit shorter. Or add me on Facebook to get that link for how to join the Broadband TV team. Let's go back to the Alexa sites. So that's YouTube. You need to monetize that YouTube stream while using that YouTube stream to then display your material. So it's a two-pronged sword. You're displaying your material. It's a three-pronged sword. You're displaying your material on your website using a YouTube playlist. You're gathering traffic from YouTube, and you're getting paid by YouTube. So it's a three-benefit situation there for YouTube. And coincidentally, it's ranked three on the top 500 sites. Amazon, I understand it's a little harder to implement Amazon, okay? But just think about making collections of your instrumentals or collections of your songs instead of just song by song. Unless it's a single, it's going to be a little bit different. Yahoo.com, are you ranked in Yahoo? Same as Google, pretty much. Wikipedia, again, it's going to probably take some celebrity and authority to get on Wikipedia. So that's a little bit different. That's some PR stuff involved. Twitter.com, you need to be making sure it matches your Facebook and all your other social media. Okay, so those are the key functions of those websites. So I didn't just give you websites to go to. I gave you how to use those websites to then better your brand. And I'm saying brand a lot because I do mean the influence. When I say brand, put it this way. When I'm talking about brand, we're talking about influence. When I say marketing, we're talking about money. Okay. So when I say brand, we're talking about long-term influence. Like the people we know from thousands of years ago still have massive influence in today's culture. People who have died are still alive through influence. Okay. And that's what branding is all about, influence. Whereas marketing is about dollar bills. It's about the flow of an exchange of monetary or money, I should say. So now let's, you know, get into one more place you can go, eZine Articles. What you want to do is come up with some information you can share with everybody, okay? And write an article. And in the article, you can leave your link at the bottom of the article. So when people use these articles for their magazines or for their websites or whatever it may be, you can then be linked as a backlink in their website. So you're expanding your reach simply by putting, by giving value to other people to use for free. Okay, so you're exchanging your article writing for a possible backlink from somebody else or credit from somebody else. Okay, so that's what zinearticles.com is all about. So you want to at least have something to write about. So after this quick break, we're going to move into some producer news. We're going to talk about Obama and Kendrick Lamar. We're going to go over SoundCloud and some functionalities you need to understand, as well as the 10 best controllers and sequencers of 2015 and the 10 best audio interfaces of 2015. Want to learn how to make beats like the pros? Join now for free at busyworksbeats.com and learn the secrets of the pros. Create complete compositions with comprehension. Master music theory. Visit busyworksbeats.com/music theory for your free bonuses and free music theory tutorials. Professional mixing secrets finally revealed. Get 3 free videos straight from the new Mixing Academy complete course package at busyworksbeats.com/Mac. All right, we're back from our first break here at busyworksbeats.com, the new podcast series here at busyworksbeats.com/podcast, where you get your producer news and you get the music production inside information. So now we're going to step into Obama name's favorite song, book, and movie of 2015. Now we have to ask ourselves, why is Obama even mentioning these things? Why is he mentioning these things? If you noticed, Obama's presidency is based on social. It's based on culture. It's based on things that aren't aggressive, like war or money. It's based on, you know, healthcare, which is a cultural idea. It's based on, you know, different social media things that kind of blew up because of Obama. And he's bringing people together socially. That's his job. Whereas the last president was about handling the war and getting the money straight. Okay, so it's kind of a reverse of roles, I would say, or a reverse of focus in the presidency. So his brand is that he was all about the people, the social. Okay, so what's the point here? How does this relate to you as a music producer? The point here is that Kendrick Lamar got mentioned by the president, Obama, Barack Obama, basically the ruler of the free world. Okay, now the point here is that, let's see, this was from Washington Times, and it says President Barack Obama says his favorite song of 2015 is How Much a Dollar Cost by Grammy nominated rapper Kendrick Lamar. So now Kendrick Lamar has a massive social proof and traffic source for his song How Much a Dollar Cost. This is why I say music delves into every other industry. It's not just the music industry. We focus too much on artist to artist deals. You have to understand that music is an influential tool, okay? It's not just about the money of a song, which it is mostly, but it's about the influence of the song. Songs are the only thing which can get into a different culture and make other cultures get hip to our culture. That's why other cultures are trying to ban American movies, because our movies are implanting ideas and concepts into other cultures' minds, and they are becoming more, you know, accepting of American ways by our movies. Same with our music. And this is why we step into so many different industries. So the funniest part is that the song is called How Much a Dollar Costs. Okay. And Obama's whole brand or platform is that he's all about the people, the social, how much a dollar costs. So he's kind of stepping away from, you know, money, making people feel like money is not what we're here for in America. We're all about peace and helping each other out. So that's, you know, this is another staple for Obama so he can support his healthcare ideas. So it's like, give up your dollar to help your brother over here in America. Okay, whether you believe in it or not, that's not the point. The point is that this is a marketing tool. It benefits two people at the same time. You know, Obama, you know, why would he pick this song out of all the songs on Kendrick Lamar's album? This shows that he had to listen to the song, listen to the album, which means he went through every song on the album, which also says that he went through the album. Okay, so that's another social proof element for Kendrick Lamar. Now, how this came about, I'm not sure. If there were some business meetings, I don't know how Kendrick Lamar got the cosign of the president. Maybe the president just wanted this song to kind of be the title, because why else would you pick a song called How Much a Dollar Costs, right? So you really have to think deeply when you start to see stuff like this, when you see very influential people digging into the social aspect of our culture. You really need to step back and say, okay, is this a marketing thing? Is this something to set up something else? What is the play here as to why he would even mention Kendrick Lamar and also mention How Much a Dollar Costs? Now, if you look at the Kendrick Lamar album cover, it's a picture of people in front of the White House. And there's a dead white guy. I'm assuming that's representing some president or something. Okay. So it's like black people took over the White House. Now, you have to understand that Kendrick Lamar is a huge influence in the music industry. His music is influencing people. He is a leader of culture. And if you remember, Obama's whole strategy is winning the culture, expanding the culture to take over new territories of the world using culture. Okay, because culture is the thing that doesn't require war. It's about influence at that point. And, you know, this is symbolic, okay? So it's like black people are taking over the White House. So that represents Obama's presidency for the most part. And it's, you know, it all ties together. And then magically Obama picks the song, How Much Does a Dollar Cost? You know, to relate with us people in America. You know, how much does a dollar cost? The funniest part about politics, and I'm not here to debate politics and your beliefs. The point here is that if you look at the Democrats who preach, you know, socialism or the other aspects of sharing money, I can't think of the words. I'm not a politician, but the aspects of sharing money between people, if you look at their bank account, they are millionaires. Okay. You need to look at the top people running for these Democratic offices and see how rich they really are. It's crazy. They're like hundreds of millions rich. Okay. It's not just thousands or million rich, it's hundreds of millions rich. So you really need to go reinvestigate the net worth of these big players in the Democratic Party who are preaching this money sharing thing, when they're actually the people that is posed as the enemy for the most part. Okay, so that is how it's affecting music production. So you can get the cosign of the president of the free world and get your song blasted to a completely new level into new countries based on his cosign. So it just shows how far music can go as a music producer. So that's, you know, I'm showing you the bigger picture so you can step back and really see, okay, music doesn't just affect the music industry. We're affecting businesses, millions of businesses. We're affecting countries, okay? It's massive how much influence music has. Now, I wanted to step back because on SoundCloud, here's another platform a lot of people use, and they think this is a great way to get traffic, okay? So let's type in hip-hop beat. Now, if I'm looking for a hip-hop beat and I type it into SoundCloud, where's your account? It's probably on the 500th page of SoundCloud. The thing about SoundCloud is it doesn't have a very high-tech search engine. It is high-tech, but I mean, it's not like a Google or a YouTube. So it's pretty straightforward, and it's whoever got there first is the person who's getting the traffic. You type in hip-hop beat, this guy's getting all the traffic. HHC Red Beats, 12 million views, probably on a beat that, you know, sounds like whatever. Okay. So it just shows how being first is one of the keys in marketing, being first. Obama's the first black president, which led to an album of these people celebrating the first black president, getting rid of the symbolic white president. I'm not even sure why there's a white guy laying there. I really don't know the message there. But it's a symbolic thing. They're celebrating that first black president. And what's in their hands? Dollar bills. Okay. Oh, how much does a dollar cost? It all ties together. How much does a dollar cost? They're holding dollar bills. It represents the first black president. The first black president speaks on how much does a dollar cost. One of the songs in the album. I didn't even know this was a song on the album. That's how in the album it was. So it just shows how, you know, culture is the top dog, okay? And music that you create is culture. You need to understand that power. Unless you understand that power, you're never going to get the value that you need to receive. So again, if you're not first, who's going to find you on SoundCloud? I have to know your exact name. If I even type in Busy Works Beats, I'm not even sure if I pop up. BusyWorks Beats. Okay, we pop up. But okay, so if you know what I'm saying? So it's, but if you scroll down, it says nothing to do with, you know, produced by me, supposedly. I don't even know what these songs are. I never heard them. Okay. This is a project we have. So only one of the results, you have my page, which is one, and then you have one playlist, which is something of mine, and you have my playlist coming up at the bottom. So when people are searching for my material, they're not even finding my material on SoundCloud. So you need to understand why people use SoundCloud. It's not to gain traffic. It's to use it as a playlist, as a demo station. That's it. That's its only function, is to be used as a demo station and to possibly reach people you couldn't reach before. It's not about mastering a keyword. So I wanted to clear that up, because before the break, we talked about getting traffic to your website. Now let's continue into some more producer related news. Let's talk about the 10 best controllers and sequencers of 2015. Now the thing about these lists is that every year there's a new list, and every year there's something different on the list. And there can't be, you know, let's say there were 3 years, 2013 to 2014 to 2015. Let's say there were 3 years, and every year you had a top 10 best controller. That means there are 30 top controllers for 3 years. 30 top. Okay, so when people make these lists, you need to realize that it's just another way to get people to read their magazine. Nothing against Music Radar. This is actually by Future Music, so this isn't really from Music Radar. But just keep that in mind, okay? You know, take this with a grain of salt is the point. Don't consider this gospel or the only thing you can get that will get you the results, okay? We have a video on YouTube. If you type in BusyWorks Beats, trying to think of the name, Tools of the Trade, that will pull up a video of the tools of the trade used in music production, okay? And you can learn about what you actually need in a MIDI controller, okay? All these sites are just showing you the new products that probably aren't going to add the value that you're looking for. Now, my opinion, do you need drum pads on your keyboard? Some people like them, some people don't. Do you need them? No, you don't need them. Do you need seven knobs? No. You only need one workable knob. Do you need a pitch wheel, mod wheel? Yes. Those are very essential to a MIDI controller. Do you need tons of keys? Not necessarily, but if you're trying to play nice long chords and nice wide chords and be able to play different octaves all at once, you need a nice 61 key or 88 key MIDI controller. I've seen people produce records on small controllers, but again, it restricts you for building large chords like a piano player would play. So the top 10, the 10th one here is M Audio's Code Series. Again, we're looking at a picture here, so this is what I'm kind of referring to. It has about 2, 4, 6, 8 knobs on it. It has an additional 8 twisty knobs. So let's rename this. It has one master fader. It has 8 sub faders. It has 8 knobs on it. It has what looks like an XY kind of mod touch screen. It has like a play, stop, pause button area. It has drum pads, about 16 of them. And it has, it looks like 61 keys. Okay, so that's a lot to have into one MIDI keyboard. And I bet you it's like an $800, $900 keyboard. You don't need all that stuff. Okay, unless you're really inspired by it, you just don't need it. It's just, you only need what I said, one twisty knob or one up and down knob to control automation. A pitch knob, a mod wheel, and you know, if you want to play large chords, you want to have 61 keys or 45 keys plus, 49 keys plus. So that's all you really need. Let's move into the next controller, the top 10 best controllers and sequencers of 2015. The Native Instruments Traktor S5 was named one of the top controllers. Now this one's for DJs to, you know, deal with their live sets and their stems. So this is more for the DJ scene. I've tried the, I believe it was the Traktor, the bigger one. I'm not sure if this is the biggest one, but I've tried it and I did like the drum pad setup. I didn't know how to use the controller. I didn't know how to use the program. So it was kind of, it was all new, but I did like the way it felt. You felt like you were doing something as a DJ. So I will say that it does make you feel like you're doing something so you can actually achieve stuff. Because the first thing you need to have is the feeling that you're doing something, the inspiration to then go do it. Okay, so now we have the iKai MPC Touch. So the MPC is kind of evolving over time. It went from, you know, a piece of hardware that has sounds in it to now a MIDI controller. And they're trying to, I guess, compete against Native Instruments machine. But we'll see how it plays out. It looks like a 16-pad controller with a display screen here where you can see your waveforms and then some function buttons and about four knobs to the right. You know, it looks small. So probably something for somebody just getting started or who likes the Akai brand. The next one is a sequencer, the Korg SQ1. I never used it. But again, when you're starting to get into hardware, you need to realize that a lot of the stuff is just overpriced for what you're looking for. And the reason it's overpriced is because when people make hardware versions, it gives a reason for people to charge more. You know, software can do the same exact thing, if not better. So I really look into software options when it comes to hardware stuff like a sequencer. I mean, you can really get that stuff done in your DAW nowadays. You don't need this hardware stuff. But if you're inspired by the hardware analog world, go for it. Here is the Roger Linz Design Linstrument. Never saw this. It looks like something new. Looks like I have no idea. I can't even explain or describe what this even looks like. I can't think of that game where people, I think it's called Shuffleboard, where you have this long stick with like a U shape on the end of the stick and you push like a hockey puck across like, you know, some kind of asphalt kind of surface and you have to get it inside of a triangle. It looks like one of those kind of shuffleboard. sorry, I'm thinking of an episode of like Rugrats, but shuffleboard scenarios. It looks like a big shuffleboard playground thing, but you can touch it. And it looks like Ableton Live's push, but a whole bunch of buttons. Hard to explain unless you see it. That's why you got to go to busyworksbeats.com/podcast to see the visual of what we just looked at. Here's the Akai Advance. Again, drum pads that you probably don't need. Knobs that you're probably not going to touch. So the drum pads and the knobs are really just flashy stuff, to be honest, when it comes to a MIDI controller. So I would really rethink spending more money for those. The Novation Launchpad looks like the image, the Ableton Live push. It looks the same except buttons put in different places. Third one here is the Roly Seaboard Rise. Now this one's innovative because it's completely different. It's a keyboard based on touch sensitivity. It's not your classic keyboard with keys. It has like some kind of masking kind of device to where it's like all one film and you're touching it based on your sensitivity. I think Jordan something, I forget his last name, did a demo of this. I mean, it sounded good. We'll see how advanced it gets. But think of it, you know how the MIDI controllers now have those touchpad mod wheels and touchpad pitch wheels. This is like a touchpad for everything, like the keyboard and other functions of the keyboard. So it's like a touchpad instead of a classic keyboard. Now, the second pick here for the top 10 best controllers and sequencers of 2015, this one is the Arturia BeatStep Pro, so I'm assuming it's a sequencer. Again, it looks like maybe like a Native Machine build almost, but it's not a machine, like a Machine Micro, but pulled horizontally, so it's a little bit elongated. It's a rectangle shape. It looks the same, pretty much. Looks like Machine drum pads. They must get all their materials from the same vendor. Because it looks literally the same. What was I going to say here? The BeatStep reminds me of something like the Dave Instruments Tempest, something like that, like a drum machine. So again, when you're dealing with hardware, you really got to think, can you get it the same results in your software? First controller pick here in 2015 is the Ableton Push 2. I haven't tried it. I guess people like it because finally Ableton has like something you can use to kind of manipulate all its functions. So it's kind of really just an extension of Ableton, and that's why it's so highly ranked. But again, I have the Native Instruments machine, and I can tell you that those MIDI controllers are, you know, unless you're really dedicated to producing on those, it's really just a sub element in your whole system. I don't use it very much. It's just more convenient to use software approaches in my MIDI keyboard. But I do like it for certain things, like chopping up a sample, playing different parts all at once. There are different reasons I would use it. But again, just really consider, you know, if your DAW costs $500 and the controller for the DAW costs thousands of dollars, you know, $1,000, just really reconsider where you can put that money, you know, from the gate. You know, you can use that money for building a website, which is going to generate more money for you. You have to ask, how can I put this to work to get money? If you can't put it to work right away to give you an instant return on investment, I would really rethink grabbing these extensive pieces of hardware. So let's go to the next article by Future Music. Future Music likes to do a lot of top 10 articles. The top 10, or the 10 best audio interfaces of 2015. This one's from number 10 is Novation Audio Hub 2X4. Now, the thing about these top lists is you really have to ask, okay, the person who wrote the article, did they really go into the audio store and A-B every single audio interface? Okay, because if they didn't, then you have to ask, how would they even know the quality of every single audio interface? So that's why I like to say, take these lists with a grain of salt. Just take them as ideas. So I'm going to brush through these 10. I'm not going to go over the features. What you need in an audio interface is at least two inputs. I found that's the best because you could do stereo inputs, a left and a right. At least two inputs, a quarter inch, you know, XL, you know, meaning XLR and quarter inch dual inputs so that you can plug in an XLR mic, or you can do a quarter inch plug-in as well. So have that dual capability on the input. Those are what you need to look for. You also need to look for phantom power. Make sure it has phantom power. Obviously, if it has XLR inputs, hopefully it has phantom power. And on the back, I would actually consider a MIDI input, just in case you have some older synth that needs to be plugged in so you can get the time sync right and have that MIDI link linking up a lot faster instead of dealing with audio all the time. So anyway, those are what you need to look for your audio interface. Now, each of these interfaces has a different approach. So this one has the number 9 iConnect Audio 4. It has four inputs. Do you need four inputs? Typically, probably not. The Audient ID 14, can't even see the inputs. Looks like a DI quarter inch. It looks like a no mic input, however. So you really want to look at the specs there. The IK Multimedia Pro Duo looks like I can't tell if that's another XLR input. It looks like two XLR inputs or a quarter inch and an XLR. I can't tell from the picture. But it's very small, and it looks like it's for portability. Number 6 is Steinberg's UR12. Never heard of it. It has one mic input, and that's it. And what is that? Can't tell what the other input is, but it's another input. It looks like a quarter inch input. So again, you want to make sure you have those dual capability inputs. I found those are the best, or at least have two dedicated sections to where you can plug it in. The fifth pick here is, I don't even know how to pronounce this company, Apogee's Ensemble Thunderbolt. Now, a lot of people think that they need to get the UAD or the Apogee Apollo to use UAD plugins. You don't have to get that interface to use the plugins. You can get a PCIe card, what it's called, or a satellite to run the program or whatever it's called, the DSP, to then manage the plugins. You don't need to get the audio interface. You can actually go with one of the lower options money-wise and still use the plugins. So just keep that in mind, because when I was getting the UAD plugins, I was considering them, and I thought I had to get the interface, but you don't need the interface. You just need something from the company to then unlock the plugins. So here, number 4 is the Apollo Twin. Again, these high-end sort of interfaces, really have to ask yourself, is there going to be a huge difference? You need to A-B these in the store and not just go by hype, because you can overpay tremendously. The RME Babyface Pro, I've never seen it before, is number 3. Number 2 is the Focusrite Claret 8 Pre. Yeah. I think this is looks like a preamp slash, I can't really tell what the knobs do in the front. Maybe they're just gain knobs, I'm not even sure. But maybe it has 8 inputs, so that's why it has 8 knobs, duh. Okay, so you can record 8 inputs at once. And the number 1, of course, is the Apollo by Universal Audio. So again, you really have to ask yourself, you know, are these functions the things I need? Because you might be aiming for these really high pieces of gear and just not need it. If you're a solo producer, you don't need these high-end interfaces, okay? You just don't. So that is a list from Future Music, the top 10 best audio interfaces of 2015. Now, if you want some surprise, actually, we'll leave that for after the break. So after the break, we're going to get into two articles we recently published to BusyWorksBeat.com, and we're going to go over some content on 8 mixing fundamentals and easy music theory techniques you can get into. So right after this break, we're going to get into it. Want to learn how to make beats like the pros? Join now for free at busyworksbeats.com and learn the secrets of the pros. Create complete compositions with comprehension. Master music theory. Visit busyworksbeats.com/music theory for your free bonuses and free music theory tutorials. Professional mixing secrets finally revealed. Get 3 free videos straight from the new Mixing Academy complete course package at busyworksbeats.com/. Welcome back to busyworksbeats.com. Now we're going to go over the 8-beat mixing fundamentals. So here at busyworksbeats.com, we write articles every now and then, and we go over some concepts you might want to apply to your music production. So here are the 8 fundamentals of mixing simplified for you. Instead of paragraphs and books written about it, I simplified it into at least 2 sentences or less, or at least 2 paragraphs or less. So the 8 fundamentals of mixing are, first, the equalizer, also called the EQ. The equalizers are used to edit out bad qualities of a sound and to also enhance a sound, okay? So when you're editing out the bad qualities, that would be something like mic hiss or rumble from your microphone, or if you accidentally push the microphone, that little blip that I just created, editing those frequencies out so that it doesn't get into the sound at the end of the day. Okay, so that's one purpose of the equalizer. The second is to enhance a sound. So you can take a nice thinned out sound and add, you know, a little body to it by pulling up the low mids a bit. Okay, so you're enhancing the sound. You're taking a sound from one place to a different place. You're enhancing it. Now, there are also, the EQs are also used to shape the tone of a sound. And the tone is the way we perceive a sound. And when I speak about tone, I'm talking about a frequency perception. Tone, for example, would be if I have more low frequencies than high frequencies, my sound would have a lower tone or darker tone. If I had more high frequencies and less low frequencies, my sound would have a brighter tone or a higher tone. It's the way we perceive a sound, and we can actually move around the tone of a sound regardless of its processing chain using EQs to reshape the way we hear the sound, just its tone. So that's what I mean when I say tone. Now, the second fundamental of mixing is a reverb. Now, reverberation is the effect you hear when you step into a large space and you make noise. It's that simple. When you step into that big church and you say something, that's reverb, where you start to hear the response from the environment. The noise you make bounces around the walls of the environment and returns back to your ears. And there's a delay in the timing. So when you speak, it takes time for that sound wave to now get to the walls, which bounces back to your ears. It takes time. And that time difference is what creates the different types of reverb. So different reverbs are created with different times of the return sound coming back to your ear. Okay, so without digging too deep into reverbs, just realize that it's really just based on a delay in time. Now, the third fundamental of mixing here is compression. Okay, and compression is used to adjust the perception of level or volume in a sound. That's all it's there for. It's to adjust the perception or level of a sound. Now, if we take a kick drum with a loud transient or the beginning portion of a sound, what's called a transient, and a soft body, and we compress it, we can then match the levels and volume of the beginning portion of the kick with the body of the kick. So when we add that compressor, we're chopping off the harshness of the transient, chopping off that volume peak, making it more linear and more consistent with the body of the kick. And that's how we can, you know, morph our kick. And this would make the kick seem longer because we've change the perception of the kick simply because the volume was made more constant. Now, there are more functions to a compressor, including clipping distortion effects, you know, but to keep it simple, compression is used to make the volume of a sound more constant without changing, which makes a sound feel more linear or flattened. So that's the main function of a compressor, is to make things feel more flattened and more linear. The fourth fundamental of mixing is a limiter. Limiters are really just compressors with harsher characteristics. Okay, so that's really what they are. Limiters are compressors with higher ratios. They are known to set what are called ceilings, which are used to make sure sound levels, the volume of a sound, don't go above a specific dB level. And that's what the ceiling of a limiter does. And this is used to prevent clipping in a track. This is why people add limiters to their master track at 0 dB, so that the track won't go above 0 dB. Again, there are more functions to a limiter as there are for the compressor, because a limiter is essentially a compressor. The fifth fundamental here is saturation. Okay, there are many different styles of saturation, but saturation essentially makes the sound more aggressive, more buzzy, more fizzy, or more pronounced. And some techniques involving saturation are to create upper harmonic activity, to give low frequency sounds more activity in the higher frequency range. And this technique is used to make low kicks and bass audible. So if you have an 808 or a kick drum, we use tape saturation or different saturation techniques so that on lesser quality systems like radios or lo-fi headphones, people can actually hear that it's there. Because on those headphones, they don't support bass tones as much. And people won't even know you have a kick drum in your song if it doesn't have that higher frequency range tag to it. So think of saturation like light distortion, okay? Now, the sixth fundamental of mixing is delay, okay? And delay is created with time differences. That's all it means, is a time difference, a delay. If I say the word high and you say it 10 milliseconds later, like hi, hi, that is a delay between the two instances of saying hi. So anytime there's difference between two things, that's when delay is occurring. Now, we can use delay for many things in mixing. One main reason is to use delay for increasing the presence of a rhythm in a track and solidify the motion created in the track. So for example, if I say hi, I can add a delay that now continues on that signal. So I can say hi, and if I add a delay, it would be high, 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 and it would continue on. It's also called echo. So now the seventh fundamental of mixing is distortion. Now, distortion is the reshaping of a sound from its original shape. So think of distortion like warping or distorting an image. You know, if you throw a rock into a pond, it now has ripples in the pond. That's distorting the image of the pond. Just like walking through a house of mirrors exaggerates your figure, distortion will exaggerate your sound. And it is essentially very aggressive saturation, even involving digital clipping going above digital 0 dB. Now, there are many aspects to distortion, but in short, it's an aggressive type of sound that you can get. Now, the last fundamental is understanding mono and stereo. So think of your song in three positions: left, center, and right. Left and right would be the stereo sound or the side sound. The middle would be the mono sound, okay? But don't mix mono with center panning, okay? Don't confuse mono with center panning, however, because mono can be panned left and right. So to simplify it, think of left, center, and right. To keep it simple, just realize that there are three main sections to a song: the mono and the stereo field, which are left and right. And you can manipulate the three positions for unique results in your songs. So we have a video here at busyworksbeats.com/Mac or /MAC. You can sign up with your email to get more free mixing videos. But if you want to learn more about mixing, you want to watch our video here at busyworksbeats.com/mix-beats-easily. Mix Beats Easily, or you can go to our YouTube page and look for our playlist called How to Mix Beats Easily, which is a free pre-course on how to mix. It's not the actual course, it's a pre-course. So now let's get into the next article we've written for you. And this is that music theory does not have to be complicated. Now, this one you have to actually visit the page because it's video involved. But just, there are 3 points to getting through music theory, and we're going to go through those 3 points really quickly. So the first is to understand chord codes. Chord codes can be created without any scale. And that's the best part about the chord codes, is that you don't need to have a specific scale. You don't need to know anything about scales. You could just build chords based on numbers, and it's a number system. And we show you how to actually use that number system. So you need to understand those chord codes first in music theory to make it more simple for you. Now, secondly, is that the concept of naming comes last. It comes after the fact. So my biggest issue with the way music theory is taught in university and everywhere else in the world is that they teach you scales first, and then they say, okay, if you want to build a major chord, it's the 1-3-5. Okay, well, if I don't have a scale, if I don't know what the scale is, how am I going to create a major chord? And that's why we teach you the number system. But also, they say build the major scale. Okay, so how do I build the major scale if I don't memorize it? It's not about memorization. We show you how to actually build scales from scratch. You don't have to memorize, okay, the minor scale is all the white notes from A to A, if that's the A natural minor scale. But one way is to do that is to memorize it. Another way is to know how to actually build scales. So this is what we're digging into, the core fundamentals of music. That's why the chord codes, we even have scale codes in our product called Music Theory in a Day, which goes over those concepts extensively. And you can build music from just numbers, and it's easier to do it, okay? And that's the best part, is that it's easier to do it. You don't have to memorize anything. The only thing you have to memorize is a chord code, which is actually overrides, you know, memorizing shapes of chords or memorizing some scale, because you can move it anywhere on your keyboard and it still works. So that's the difference between Music Theory in a Day and every other music theory course on the planet for the most part. Okay, but the concept here is that naming comes last. You know, you name the minor scale after you create it. Okay, and a scale, just in a quick summary of a scale, is that scales are a sequence of notes which we prefer. That's it. Different cultures have different scales. Everything's not Western music based. Okay, a scale is just a sequence of notes which we want to hear in sequence. That's it. And then we name the scale after the fact. So the biggest problem is that we put the name first and then we try to memorize things, and that makes it so confusing to get into music, because people are memorizing things, not understanding that it's making things harder down the line. Now the third point here with music theory and why people make it so complicated is that you only need a scale in one chord. Okay, believe it or not, all you need to make great music is to learn how to build chords from a scale and the major chord code, which is 047. Again, if you want to learn more about that chord code technology, you want to go to busyworksbeats.com/music theory. There's a free video going over the chord codes. All you have to memorize is 047, and you can build chords from your scale, from your actual scale, once you map it out. So lots of chords are derived from the 047 chord code, which is explained if you're reading the actual article here. You'll go back to step one and actually watch that video. So anyway, we have another video called How to Create Chords Using a Scale. You can go to busyworksbeats.com/music theory to get all these videos for free. Okay, so we have them all there for you. But those are my pet peeves about why people make music theory so complicated for no reason. Okay, and we simplify it for you at busyworksbeats.com/music theory. Now lastly, as you can tell, I'm running out of breath. We're going to answer your questions here at BusyWorks at the new producer community here on facebook.com/groups/busyworksbeats. And we wrote a post here. It says, audio podcast, what should I go over today? And I let you have about an hour to reply. So the first one's from Johnny. He says, vocal recording, processing of them, and mixing of vocals. Since that's hard to explain in an audio podcast, you want to go to busyworksbeats.com/Mac, M-A-C, Mac. And you'll get more free mixing videos there. This one's from Miguel. Finishing songs and writing lyric. Without digging into the technology of songwriting, to finish a song, you want to go on our YouTube page and look up the Oasis method. And that will show you how we take 8 bars and build a song with just 8 bars. So that's how you finish a song. Or if you want to expand on those technologies, go to busyworksbeats.com/beatmagic. As far as writing lyric, you need to understand that lyric comes from sound. So a technology you can use right away is to hum, sing, whistle over your track, and really understand the accents of what you're whistling or singing. Understand what you're doing with your cadence and your rhythm of speech, even if it's gibberish, and then translate that into lyric. Okay, so translate the sound into lyric later, but your idea has to be pronounced first. Your sound idea has to be pronounced first, then you add lyric. This one's from Dell. He says, where are the podcasts at? So now you can view the podcast at busyworksbeats.com/podcast. And now we're on iTunes. Here on iTunes, and we'll be sure to give you that link for sure. This one's from Dell again, YouTube. Okay, so that's just a reply. This one's from Russ. Briefly, the importance of providing value and service to others so that you receive back and at the same time grow your influence. So if I had a little more time, I would dig more into this. Maybe in the next podcast, I'll dig into this. So the importance of providing value and service. So let's start at value. You know, the biggest thing I see with producers, again, they're wondering why they're not selling, is because you have to ask the question, who am I creating value for? You know, who is my audience? Who am I even here to serve? You need to figure that out first. You need to find who you're serving. And in the beginning of the video and of the podcast, we went over ways where you can access multiple people and how to figure out how to serve them. So that's the first step, is figuring out who. The second step of creating value is figuring out what they actually need. Okay, so you need to figure out, okay, what do they need? I mean, it sounds simple, but a simple survey can clear that up. Then the service, the importance of providing service. Now, a lot of people get caught up in the concept of customer service, the concept of taking care of people who already bought from you, which is a good thing to have, which increases the happiness of your business. But you have to understand, business is about growing as well. So if you spend too much time trying to take care of people you've already served, you're neglecting more people you can serve. And ultimately, you're really sacrificing growth for more happiness in the people that you have. And just a quick synopsis of this is that when people find their solution through you, you know, the chances of them needing more and more solutions from you are getting slimmer and slimmer. Okay. You know, because it becomes more niched and more precise from that point on. So you really have to, instead of sacrificing your larger audience for one customer, you know, you really need to try and look to grow. But customer service is needed, of course, and service is what separates companies from different companies. But again, the big misconception is that customer service is king, when in reality, if it were all based on how happy people were with your, for example, Xbox, Halo 2. I mean, Halo 2 is a great game, you know, and I can play it today, and it's a great game, and it's a great game because it's a great game. You know, I don't need new graphics. I don't need new whatever, okay? It's just a great game to play, period. Now, what they did is focus on new customers. They made Halo 3, Halo 4, Halo 5. Whereas if they just stopped at Halo 2, and wanted to make people happy, they would just constantly add more maps to Halo 2. But they're not trying to just constantly make their old audience happy. They're trying to expand. So that's where you have to balance, you know, your energy level of how much are you taking care of your clients and how much are you trying to actually grow your company. So again, putting everything into service sacrifices new business. And like I said, people won't necessarily need lots from you after you deal with them the first time. So for example, people who bought Halo 2, the question is, did they buy Halo 3, Halo 4, and Halo 5? Or is it that they were looking for new audiences for each Halo? Okay. So that's a way to look at it. So briefly, the importance of, and also I meant to say that people who went through Halo 2, Halo 3, Halo 4, Halo 5, you know, those are very few, the people who bought all the series. You know, it's like watching The Godfather. Did you watch all three of The Godfather, or did you just watch the first one or the second one? Did you watch, you know, all five seasons of Breaking Bad, or did you just watch the first one and just kind of get the gist and leave? So that's what you have to look at. To others so that you receive back and at the same time grow your influence. So it's a balance, okay, when you're growing business. Now, influence is branding, which is a little bit different. So influence, again, that'll take too long to actually explain. So with that, I'll leave that as a trail for the next audio podcast. We're going to go over influence and why it's important, and to look at how to look at money and influence. So let's look at the question from Sura. He says, variations and transitions in a beat. Well, I can't do that in an audio podcast. So if you want to learn more about variations and transitions, you can go to our YouTube page. We have plenty of videos on that topic. Bass versus 808. Typically, you're going to have either or, because the 808 is going to occupy such a wide frequency range, typically from 100 hertz down. And you don't want to have too many clashes in your bass frequencies. So you really have to save up that area for something. You know, you can't, a lot of people try to stack bass elements on an 808 and a kick. Do you know how many elements that is in the bass frequencies? And bass frequencies is the top area where you're going to have frequency clashing, because that's where the sound waves are so slow that you can actually hear the wobble, the clashing in the sound frequencies. So you really got to be careful in the bass range. We have videos on how to actually take care of the bass range at busyworksbeats.com/Mac. When you sign up with your email, you're going to get free videos on how to deal with a kick and an 808 together, and how to combine the two properly. So bass versus 808, you got to sacrifice. You got to pick one, unless you understand how to layer the frequencies properly through mixing, which is an extensive artwork and craft. Now, this one's from Norbert about song structures on the different genres. So typically, just a quick synopsis of songwriting, song structure. We go over this in Music Theory in a Day and Beat Magic about song structure, but song structure in different genres, the only thing that really separates the genres is the pre-chorus. And pre-chorus is used in the pop genres and in pop genres. So rock, okay, EDM, anything pop usually has a pre-chorus in it. That's just how it is. Now, hip-hop, on the other hand, doesn't necessarily have a pre-chorus all the time. So that's what, here's the difference. Okay, pop is based on lyric that is not based on rhythm or based on some kind of content. Like hip-hop is based on the lyric only, right? Whereas pop music is based on melody and the lyric. So you have a little more room to write out longer melodies. So you can take up a little more room with melody. Whereas hip-hop, you have to say words, and you have to use a lot of words. So in hip-hop, we use a 16-bar verse. Whereas in pop music, you will split the verse. Even though it's a 16-bar stretch, you're going to split the verse into an 8-bar verse section where you tell your story, and then the pre-chorus where you start to build up to the chorus, but it still seems like part of the verse. So really, it's an 8-bar verse, 8-bar pre-chorus, then an 8-bar chorus. Whereas in hip-hop, you're going to go 16-bar verse and then 8-bar chorus. There's no pre-chorus. Those are the main differences between all the song structures there. And you can learn more about song structure at busyworksbeats.com/beatmagic. So that wraps it up for the first podcast here. It's probably going to be longer next time. And we're here on iTunes. We'll give you those links. And you want to go to busyworksbeats.com/podcast to get the visuals for this podcast. So thanks for watching today. It's busyworksbeats.com.
Want to learn how to make beats like the pros? Join now for free at busyworksbeats.com and learn the secrets of the pros. Create complete compositions with comprehension. Master music theory. Visit busyworksbeats.com/music theory for your free bonuses and free music theory tutorials. Professional mixing secrets finally revealed. Get 3 free videos straight from the new Mixing Academy Complete Course Package at busyworksbeats.com.